the cold grip of his presence. Sense the clammy excitement of his evil. Taste the sharp fear that he alone can bring.
Dracula's blood.
This way, gentlemen.
We know the way.
These men thought they had tasted all that life had to offer.
Ready when you are, gentlemen.
Would you be willing to sell your souls to the devil?
If one thought that one's experience might be extended.
It would be extended to infinity.
There's someone there.
Dracula is back to choose his human victims.
Alice.
Who are you? How do you know my name?
Dracula is back to select his companions in darkness, who must die that he may live. If you shock easily, stay away.
She's neither dead nor alive.
Lucy! 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 Patricide! Patricide is in the way! The marks on her neck! She's a vampire!
Prepare yourself. Every nerve, every muscle.
No.
Prepare yourself for the greatest shock of all.
Hello, welcome to Movie Humpers. I'm Bob Sham.
I'm Angela.
And the sounds you hear may be dogs.
Yes.
And we are winding down Halloween Humpfest. Every weekday, all month long, we dropped a different horror discussion. And this is our last of the Hammer Horror Draculas. We couldn't get to them all.
No.
There's Christopher Lee appears in seven total Hammer Horror Draculas. The ones we won't get to are Scars of Dracula, Dracula AD, and The Satanic Rites of Dracula. Great title.
Ooh, yeah.
But from what I understand, in terms of the quality ones, we may have covered those. I haven't seen the rest of them, but you know, you see the critical admiration drop off kind of quick after Taste the Blood. The one where Taste the Blood of Dracula from 1970, the one we're doing today.
Yes.
Directed by Peter Sasdy.
Is Dracula and his vampire bride? That's a Van Helsing.
The Brides of Dracula.
No, there's another one called And His Vampire Bride. Saw it today.
Apparently there's a couple more Draculas beyond the Christopher Lee.
Yeah, and I think it had the Van Helsing dude, but not Christopher Lee.
It's hard to imagine.
You know. Well, we got one like that already.
But he wasn't Dracula. He was the Baron. I'm talking about someone else is playing Dracula.
Yeah, I don't like that.
Yeah, Christopher Lee. So it's got to be Christopher Lee, Bela Lugosi.
Or Nicolas Cage.
Nicolas Cage. And Gary Oldman that one time. We'll take that.
I don't know. That hair.
That Dracula can't be that erotic, you know?
I almost started watching that this afternoon, and I was like, I think I want to just stay with the Dracula I'm with right now.
Although we had the young version where he was kind of in his civilian clothes with the long, dark hair. And then we had Bunhead, old man one.
Bunhead is the one in my mind. It's been a long time since I've seen it. Because it's a very young Winona Ryder, Keanu Reeves.
Yeah, yeah. You know, the Dracula here, I think there's a lot of fun things to grab onto here. I kind of like some of the concepts of this one. But it seems like Dracula's game is a little off on this one, don't you think? It seems like he's making, we'll get more into the weeds of it, but it seems like he's making some, like mistakes that it's like this isn't my horned up fuckboy Dracula.
I agree.
His game is a little off here.
But I think it's because in this one, it's all about revenge.
So
he's maybe like blinded by revenge and being dumb.
Well, even his motivation of revenge is weird.
It is very weird. It doesn't make any sense.
We got a comment on our Brides of Dracula where apparently we had stated after the Baron got defeated by standing in the shadow of a windmill in mm-hmm. the shape of a cross, and we had stated, a listener pointed out that we had stated, Dracula would never go out like that. And then the listener was like, you haven't gotten into the sequels. Now, in Dracula, Prince of Darkness, you know, that's a pretty soft ending, but the setup and what defines Christopher Lee as the Dracula there is just so juicy. Like, I do really enjoy that movie quite a bit. But yeah, at the end of this one, it is kind of almost, I wouldn't say it's quite as bad as like standing in the shadow of a windmill.
It's not as bad as that.
But That's the worst one. But it's not far off. It's because it's also a situation of like, oh shit, I'm standing here. You know, it's kind of a similar kind of thing.
It has more to do with like the religious like sacrament though, right? Like, isn't it like a...
Yeah, but...
It at least has some more basis in like the magical, mystical, religious stuff than just like a fucking windmill.
Look, we're going to
Hi, person who made that comment. We're glad that you're watching and listening and we love you. But I disagree.
We haven't watched the rest of the Draculas. We don't know how they end. That was this one, which is
what you were doing.
What that commenter's point was, that we haven't seen all those.
Okay, but overarching, and I don't care if I haven't seen them all, Christopher Lee is better. And that Baron was stupid.
The argument wasn't that the Baron is better than Christopher Lee.
I'm just saying that.
That wasn't the
argument. I'm just
no,
saying it.
No one's denying
and
that.
And no one should.
No. Ice cream is delicious.
Pizza is great.
Yeah, pizza. Yay. I love sustaining myself with food. And that may be controversial. But I might get canceled for that, but I love it when people say shit like that.
Sleep is important.
Be like, I might get canceled for this, but I don't think people should be hitting each other. Like, I feel like half of Reddit is shit like that. I might get canceled for saying this, but I think butter pecan is better than strawberry. Like, what?
Someone needs to explain to them what canceled means.
It's so vague at this point anyway. Like, why are you really afraid of... It's almost like they're trying to preface their opinion, which is half the time not brave or interesting.
It's the new, this might be controversial.
Like, are you really afraid of being canceled for, like, your mundane opinion on anything?
No, they're not. What they're doing is thinking they're cleverer than they are. And I did just say cleverer. More clever.
So at the end of Dracula's Risen from the Grave, we see him get impaled on a cross. And
that was cool. I thought that was cool.
Yeah, it was a fine ending. I mean, getting impaled on a big golden cross. It's a pretty rocking way to die.
And this one I loved so much because it picked up at exactly the same time.
Well, the same evening. Well, we meet a man who's selling some shit in a carriage. And he shows a snow globe. And people react viscerally to it because the snow globe, isn't it of Dracula's castle?
No, I think...
Was that why they were freaking out?
No. The boy was mentally challenged.
Yeah.
And he just wanted the snow globe. And so basically what it was the guy was trying to sell it and he was trying to be like, five. I don't know what the... I can't remember the kind of money. But let's say he was like, give me five. Okay, give me three.
Yeah.
Give me two. And they weren't wanting to pay. And then the boy just started going like, give, give, give. And like kind of losing it a little bit. And then the older man was like, I do what he says if, you know, it's good for you or whatever.
So he's getting robbed.
So then he got robbed. But I think it was just more of like this is a person who is going to be violent if you don't give him what he wants. But he didn't seem like okay. But regardless, the man gets thrown out of the carriage.
So he finds himself wandering.
And then we never see those people again.
Wandering the forest. and he comes across. He happened to be there right when Dracula got impaled at the end of the last movie. So it's like an extra part of the last movie we didn't see. And he's like, oh shit. And he watches him disappear and his blood is covering everything.
Which we saw the blood happen before.
So, and the man is audibly like, the blood of Dracula.
But then the blood turns into powder.
Yeah. And he goes up and he takes the cloak and the ring and the amulet and everything he can.
And then we don't see him again for a while.
So we go into this town where we got the grumpiest motherfucking dad.
This guy
is miserable. Well, even when he's in a whorehouse, he's miserable.
This guy is miserable, and he's also the biggest hypocrite.
And he's
he's like, church, 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 and then he goes to the whorehouse.
And he's really upset at the fact that his daughter, the town hottie, is into this dude named Paul, who's the son of one of his friends.
Yeah, but no one knows he's friends with Paul's dad because they're in this like secret group that say they're going to do charity work every Sunday, every last Sunday of the month, and instead they go to a whorehouse together, and it's these like three guys that go
with this dandy man, the fabulous pimp man.
I loved him. And you would think the way these people acted, you would think that man would have hated this guy, but he was like totally fine and tolerant of him. But he was definitely very much like, gentlemen, gentlemen, you're here. Let's go. And he's like ushering them into a room and he's got special girls for
them. I could see him still being like a total homophobe. It's just anyone.
This guy's giving him what he wants.
Exactly. Anyone will use anyone to get what they want, or as long as someone is representing what they think they should in that moment.
Right. And then, you know, he's like, they're groping these girls and doing all these things to these girls. Meanwhile,
we see titties and snake dances.
Yeah, and meanwhile, he's completely reprimanding his daughter for literally talking to a boy, saying that she's behaving like a harlot.
But he's no more upbeat when he's in the whole house.
He's still a fucking grump.
Because he's done everything at this point. He's probably had girls throw up in his mouth, shit on his, probably took a wacky straw and sucked like his own piss out of his own navel. He's probably done all of this shit.
You know, I really loved the next bit because this young man comes in and he just walks in and he has no money and the girls are all like in love with him. He's this disgraced lord.
Yeah, Lord Courtly.
Lord Courtly. And he doesn't have any money, but he looks very fabulous. And he's like the guy who's like, I know the best clubs. You know, he's one of those.
Yeah.
And so the girls are like ushering him in and he's like opening every door and looking at everything. And the little man who owns it, I keep wanting to call him the madam. Sure. The madam is like, don't go in that door. Don't go in that door. These are my best customers. And he opens the door and he sees Mr. Sourpants is like riding a girl, like as far as like she's on her hands and knees and he's like straddling her like a horse. So bizarre. And then all of a sudden, because this man comes in, he stops the party.
He's like, no one's getting pussy tonight.
He's like, get these girls the fuck out of here. And then he looks at that man. He's like, who is that? And he starts telling him he's this guy. He's disgraced. He doesn't have any money, but the girls like him. They bring him in and they're like,
their goal is to achieve all hedonistic pleasures that they can have access to.
They need the Cenobites.
So yeah, this is true Hellraiser bait.
This is prime Hellraiser bait. It really is.
Give this man a box.
They do. I mean, that's the thing. It's a different kind of box. There's still some demons in there. And so,
so Courtly is like, all right, let's go to this shopkeeper. And it's the guy from the beginning.
Yeah. He basically is like, will you do anything? I just need some money. I need you to pay for something to do a ritual to give you everything you want.
And of course, the items that Courtly wants them to buy, they have to pay 3,000 guineas, and they are buying the powdered blood, cloak, amulet, and ring of the late Count Dracula.
Mm-hmm. And they're all like, Count Dracula.
The other dudes are a little like, what? Come on. And then, but Hargood is like, you want to be in our fucking hedonistic Bohemian Grove little cult, don't
yeah,
you?
They call it the circle, yeah, or the club or something. Paul's dad is straight up like sweating scared.
Yeah, yeah.
And he basically is like, you going to man up and pay for this, or are you out of the club? Like, you don't have to play with us anymore. The other guy is a little more, like, I think, curious.
So they get the shit, and Courtly leads them to this abandoned church, and he's already had it all set up with, like, like satanic imagery. It's properly desecrated.
He's like put stuff on the altar, like candles and things.
And then he gives them each a goblet, and he pours some of that red Dracula powdered blood just in each one. Just a little bit. And then he cuts his hand, and he drips. And it fills up, the goblet fills up with blood. And so they're like, yeah, we're not fucking drinking this. Why don't you fucking drink it? And Courtney's like, he's tasting screaming. The blood of Dracula. He immediately starts screaming.
And he's saying, help me, help me.
Then the other guys...
they beat him to death.
Oh, that's right. They do. They beat him to death.
They start kicking him and hitting him with things. They pick up, like, pipes and shit. And they beat him to death. And then they're like, oh, shit, we killed this guy. We gotta go.
They're mad. I mean, are they mad that they got grifted out of 3,000 guineas, essentially?
I think they're mad they got grifted. I think they're just... they just don't want anyone to know they went there.
Yeah.
And they're definitely not going to do it. And so they got to kill whoever is in charge. Now, but they've at least never killed before because they all freak out about that.
So Courtley's laying there beat. Mm-hmm. Three men leave, and then fog rolls over. And then we get this kind of cool image of Courtley essentially turns into Dracula, the Christopher Lee Dracula. Yeah.
And then it hardens, and then when it cracks open, it's
Christopher Lee.
So cool.
And Christopher Lee stands up, and you know, he's great. He's great. But then he goes,
they have destroyed my servant. They will be destroyed.
Well, the servant sacrificed himself to bring you back, even if he didn't know that's what was happening. Mm-hmm. But what were they trying to do if he didn't realize that chugging blood is going to... what if they all chug the blood? Would they all become Christopher Lee Dracula?
I wouldn't mind four Christopher Lee Draculas. That was my big question, too, because you would think the way that Christopher Lee acts, he was going to come back and then Courtney was going to be like his Renfield. Right?
Yeah.
Or he would also turn Courtney. I mean, Courtney thought he would be a vampire. Courtney thought they were going to turn into vampires and bring the master back. Or bring the master back and he would turn them. I don't know if they hadn't killed him, but like his body wasn't there.
Why would Dracula give a fuck if this dude... all that matters is that he's back.
I know. He never...
he wouldn't give a fuck. He should probably be grateful for those dudes. Like, yeah, you got him to drink this shit and now I'm back. But it becomes a revenge story. And this is where I'm going to open up with my theory here.
Okay.
That as Dracula keeps coming back, it's a little bit of diminishing returns. Like it's flawed. Like
cloning.
And Dracula returns from... Dracula returns from the grave.
Yeah.
You notice his bite marks are like gnarly and gross looking. They are, they're gross. They weren't really like that before. And they're kind of gnarly and gross in this one too. Mm-hmm. So it's like his bite is a little more infectious or something. Like... there does seem to be something off.
Mm-hmm.
A little more.
So, and in this one, he just becomes obsessed with hunting these three men.
Yeah. Yeah, and he knows who they are, and he goes immediately, and he finds Hargood's daughter, Alice, and he...
Glamours her
quite easily, and she is, like, enthusiastically, like, yeah, let's do this.
Yeah. She, just one second, her whole countenance... she is like quintessential 60s girl.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I don't know. I guess I don't know when this is supposed to be set, but like, she looked like a girl of the 60s. Like, totally. Everything about her. And it was fabulous. Like
this kind of doughy, very soft look, you know?
Yes, very like round, beautiful little face. Like, she's like cherubic.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
Yeah. So cute.
But my question here is like, he never turns her.
No.
Why?
I think so that he could use her to the extent that he did, because he basically has her doing... he has her kill her father.
Whip, Jamie.
Really
pretty great. Metal scene when she shocks his face with a shovel.
Well, and her dad was drunk and was about to, like, beat her. And yeah, she ran out. And then there's Dracula, and he's like, now.
But and if, she, like... But here's the thing is, the issue here, and as Paul, her beau, her love interest, is like, Alice is missing.
Yeah.
We only see Alice, like, when the dusk comes, no. when you would... Because no one is seeing her at any other point because she's missing.
She went to the funeral for her father. And at her father's funeral, she got her friend Annie.
Yeah.
Who's the sister of Paul. And that's during the day. So she did, like, call Annie over. Okay. And she was like, Annie was like,
I thought Alice was gone. I'm pretty sure Alice had, no one knew where Alice was.
She's just, no one knew where she was. She was in her same dress from that night. Like, she's been wearing the same party dress from that night, yellow dress. And she's been just, like, sleeping with Dracula in that old church in, like, a crypt. And so it's during the day because she goes to Annie and she calls her over and she's like,
I think her name is Lucy.
Right, it is Lucy. Sorry, Alice and Lucy. There's always a Lucy.
And a Paul.
And so she says to Lucy, she's like,
come on.
You cannot tell anyone that you saw me. You need to meet me at my house tonight. She didn't take her then. Mm. It was during the day. It was bright sunlight. And I know sometimes it looks like daylight in the nighttime because for lights and being able to see.
Yeah, they don't
But it was the middle of the day. The
cameras aren't going to capture pitch dark. But there is some moments where, like, it's darker in one shot than it is the other. Like, it's a little.
Which is why it was confusing.
Well, it's a little off.
It is. But definitely it was during the day. And then she said, tonight you need to meet me at my house.
And
I'll explain everything then.
And she brings her to Dracula.
Dracula
bites her, has mm-hmm. no problem turning her.
Mm-hmm.
There's at any point, there's so many points in which he could have bitten Alice.
Well, maybe he wanted Alice to be his familiar. Like, you do need a person to do things for you, like the priest in the last
the
movie.
The Dracula we know.
You have to have a person.
The Dracula we know is classic fuckboy. He wants the hottest dime piece to be his bride. That is the trajectory of Dracula.
Except not in this movie.
He's brain damaged.
Except not in
this movie.
There's
something off with that dude. He's not going to turn the hottest little...
He needs someone to do his daytime stuff.
You could get a dude to do that.
But he hasn't yet.
The prettiest girl he wants as a bride.
Yeah.
That is the theme from every single one.
Well, not this one, and that's why it's fucked.
That's even the scene... The theme of, like, the one he's not in.
The fact that he doesn't in this one is why I believe your theory that he gets crazier as it goes.
That's what I'm trying to explain. No, I agree with you. Is because he's not doing he's not living up to the pattern that he's going about.
Yes.
So we agree?
Yeah, I agree.
Okay.
That it's weird that he doesn't, but I'm just trying to justify, like, it also does make sense to me that he needs someone to go out during the day
but
for
anyone
him.
Could do that.
Yeah, well, I don't know.
The one, the prettiest girl in town, that's the one he wants to turn. If he's turned, like, three women, he will have no use for the other ones, but the prettiest one, he's always drawn to the pretty one.
No, you're right, but I agree with you. Yes, I do agree with you that means he's off, because in this one, that is not his goal. That's all I was saying. That's
his
not his goal.
His goal is revenge, which we've established is, like, a kind
Real
of
dumb.
A very soft, mission of revenge.
Because the other fucked up thing is that then he turns this other girl, who is also beautiful, into a vampire, gets her to kill her own father.
Yeah.
Help me!
And then she turns her boyfriend into a vampire, who's the son of the third man. He kills his father.
Yeah.
And then he goes to jail, and we never hear about him again.
There's a vampire on the
list. There's a vampire in jail.
But that last father, the third guy, he wrote a note to get to Paul.
Yeah.
And the note finds its way to Paul,
but
where
before,
he describes everything.
Yes. Before that, she runs to Dracula, and she's like, did I do a good job? Did I do good? Because she killed her daddy, and she turned her boyfriend, who killed his daddy, and she's like, aren't you so happy with me? And Dracula turns and kills her.
Yeah.
He, like, drinks her to death.
Yeah, which is another... There's always something in these movies that's like, oh, that's a new rule we didn't
know. This one was weird to me.
If he drains her and she's already vampirized, maybe she'd just be thirsty or something, but that's not going to kill
her. I've never seen... Now, she did end up in the river, and we know that vampires running water. Hate water.
Yeah.
So that is where she was found later. So maybe he like made her like knocked her out and threw her in the water. I have no idea. But yeah, classically, when we see vampires kill other vampires, it's like chaining them in a pit so that the sun gets to them the next day, or you know, staking them. Mm-hmm. Even though that's like terrible to do to your other person, you kind of want to out of sight, out of mind, turn them into dust. But yeah, that was weird. But he kills her because he has no use for her. Still hasn't turned
Alice.
But yeah, Paul.
But Paul knows where to go and what to do. So he walks in and he gets there before the things shit starts to go down. And he takes down all the satanic imagery.
But it's still light outside.
Yeah, and he sets it all up to be more of a sanctity, like a classic church.
Yeah.
And which is kind of what is Dracula's undoing, but it should have affected him like immediately. It seemed like it didn't affect him quite at first.
The sanctifying
the church is what it essentially undoes him.
It wasn't until he was on the altar.
Yeah.
When he got up on the altar, that seemed to be when he like started seeing the church as it used to be.
Yeah, when he was standing by a stained glass with a cross on it.
Yeah, what is that? He was hallucinating.
And Alice is also trying to seek the approval of Dracula.
Master, take me with you, Master.
I have no further use for you.
This ain't my fuckboy.
Spell broken.
This ain't my sad fuckboy Dracula.
Yeah. I just still love him, which is why I was trying to justify his actions, but you are right. I do agree with you. He should have turned her. I thought that was what was going to be. He was just waiting. And then to be like, everyone's dead, you're my girl, let's go home.
He had so thoroughly charmed her.
She was ready.
She would have killed Paul for him. The only reason she ran back into Paul's arm was because she's like, I'm done with you.
And then she was out of his spell.
It's like when he resurrected that he didn't get the hormones or the pituitary gland didn't come back this last time.
I thought he was going to, though, because when he first glamored her, he was doing that thing again where he's like touching her face.
Yeah. And
like kind of caressing her shoulders. Like it felt very sweet at the beginning, which is why I really did expect him to love her at the end.
The Dracula we know in his right mind would have got it in immediately.
Should have killed Paul, scooped her up, bit her neck, and went off into the sunset.
And their bride, and there she's the true bride he had been looking for at least a couple of these movies. So
I'm down.
So Dracula ends up on a balcony and he sees a cross and it freaks him out because he's in a church. And then he realizes it's not a desecrated church anymore. Paul set it up to be a church. And I guess that's the reason he freaks out and falls.
He's on the altar and he falls and like melts, right?
Well, he turns into like in our first Dracula with Christopher Lee.
Like when the sun got him.
Time gets him and he turns into like a dust, like a powder. But based on Dracula, Prince of Darkness, we already know how
that powder
just slit some fucker's throat right over those ashes. He's coming right back. So we already know that he can come back from this.
Could it be Jeremy?
Which one's Jeremy?
The one, the vampire in jail.
Oh yeah. Well, we won't know. We won't get the scars of Dracula. Maybe we'll watch it on our own time.
We personally will get to Scars of Dracula. I have anything to say about it.
It seems like at least for our own sake, we should finish
the
Christopher Lee run, even if they get more ridiculous.
I don't care. But, I love it.
But Peter Cushing does return, I believe, by Dracula AD. But yeah, that's Taste the Blood of Dracula. There is cool stuff in it. You know, you got the Christopher Lee always has that presence.
Yeah.
Even if you're questioning these decisions, but we did come up with an explanation as to why he seems a little bit off.
I liked the setup more than the way the story played out once he was arisen.
Not bad at all. It's kind of these movies after the first couple are trying to develop these characters in the town.
Yeah.
And I kind of like this idea of this like little sniveling little Illuminati group, some hedonistic powerful men, and then they're getting their comeuppance, even if the comeuppance seems to be a very forced revenge story when Dracula should just truly be like, guys, I appreciate it. Would you like to serve me into eternity? You know,
or I'll kill you right now.
Isn't that truly what they're looking for?
And why couldn't he kill them? He's Dracula.
I mean, it was pretty cool that he had his the guy's own daughter, like, crack him in the dome.
Yeah,
with a
he
shovel.
Had like
one of the best parts.
Two daughters kill and a son kill.
Yeah, he does. You know, that is a cool way to do it. Just like, it's not revenge. Well, I mean, it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
What do you care if Courtly kills himself?
That's
to bring
what I'm saying,
back?
Though. The anticipation, though, until they drank the blood. So good.
Yeah, that was cool.
I really loved the beginning of this movie.
And the set pieces are also...
The set was great.
And it's also because at this point, they've got so many Hammer horror movies under their belt. They just got all this shit.
Yeah.
So, they're just acquiring more and more of it to just use it over and over, right? But that's it. Taste the Blood of Dracula from 1970. That is the last Christopher Lee Dracula we will be discussing this month. A little soft, a little flawed, but still enough of what we like about these.
Yeah.
We do have fun watching these. Yes. But I'm going to have this 1 through 5. You're going to have 1 through 5 combined, best out of 10. Taste the Blood of Dracula. What do you think?
2.75.
I'm going to match it.
Yeah. 2.75. Almost a 3, but there's just, if it had been sexy Dracula.
5.5. 4. Taste the... You know what? I'm actually going to go to 3.
Me too.
So it's a solid 6.
Yeah.
I do think
I really loved the beginning.
This
movie is beautiful.
Yeah, there's some things on here. There's just other things that don't make any sense, but there's... It keeps you in it. It's a 6 out of 10.
I'm trying to be, like, more critical because I tend to go too high in all of these, but 3. 3 for me as well.
I think on our own time, we're going to go down our own list, and we're going to be shuffling movies around.
Oh, hell yeah.
And I think we're going to end up with a lot more D's and a few more F's and a lot more C's.
Mm-hmm.
Because then, you know, you're...
The farther that we go,
you're
in.
Going back, and it's like, you know, we didn't rate Air very high, but I think it landed in B, and like,
that's
insane.
That's not a B movie.
The Mario Brothers is pretty much a right down the middle C movie. Yeah. But it got like a B minus. So right there. But there's some things that we need to shift around.
Agree.
But I hope any viewers or listeners are not keeping particular score. Because that's not really what we're trying to be all about.
No,
we're going to contradict the fuck out of ourselves. And of course, you know, we're movie appreciators.
Absolutely.
Not movie experts.
But we are learning as we go.
Exactly. You know, you put a few hundred more reviews under our belt, and we're going to get kind of pretty good at analyzing these things, even better than we are now.
Yeah.
And someday, I can't wait to get to the point where we look back on these older episodes and we're embarrassed at ourselves.
Sure.
We'll get there. I am kind of embarrassed over some Documenteers content, at least thinking back to how...
That was our old show.
How swept up into things we so easily were back then.
I get that.
It's a 6.
6, 6, 6, 6, 6. Oh, 666. Halloween.
The number of the beast. Check it. Right at the bottom, taste the blood of Dracula.
Taste it.
Taste it. There you go. Check the show notes for links and other places to find us. Subscribe, like, leave a comment. I love fun facts.
Mm.
When people tell us fun facts about movies, I'm not going to like or comment on everything, but if you like correct me and make a good point, I might acknowledge it. But I will guarantee I will give you a like on your comment if you give me fun movie facts I didn't know. I love that shit. Tomorrow is Halloween. It's the last day of Halloween Humpfest. And
get ready.
We're talking about the first 6 Halloween movies. John Carpenter only made the first one, but then after that, you know, then we get up to the infamous Halloween 6, a very controversial one. So it is our movie review. It's going to be our movie review 6-pack episode, which we've done before. It was much more of a random selection.
Yes.
It's going to be a longer episode, but it was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be able to squeeze these in more. I kind of like these as special episodes.
I do too.
So it's a movie review 6-pack of the first 6 in the Halloween movie franchise created by John Carpenter and Deborah Hill. So the first Halloween, one of my all-time favorite horror movies.
Yep.
So you
too.
Could imagine that we probably are very nice to that one.
Yeah.
But what about the rest of them? What about that third one, that weird one? What do you think?
I like three.
We'll see. Three. All right, don't give it all away. All right, so that's that, and happy Halloween for you tomorrow. Hope you get lots of candy.
Death to all traitors.